Nokia. I'm sure you know Nokia for the cell phones. Most of us, we had this one in our pocket in the thousands. Now Nokia is, well, we have actually rebuilt the same phone, but we are still active in cell phones, smartphones, also in IoT devices, consumable. But maybe you are not aware that Nokia, it is also that. So welcome to the Nokia presentation. As you can see, Nokia is now also an AI company. My name is Nicolas Dupuis. I'm from Nokia Software, Belgium, and I'm leading the AI activities in the Digital Experience and Care Analytics group. So a lot of words. So what does it actually mean? So at home, you have all a PC, a tablet, smartphones. Plenty of devices that get connected to the internet. You watch Netflix, you put your picture in the cloud, etc. And actually, to get connected to the internet, it happened then in most of the countries in the world, the preferred medium, the preferred connection, remained the copper or the optical fiber. But in that business, and that's very important for the big telecommunication operator, there is a need for prediction. We would like to know and to predict that you are happy with your experience or you are happy with your speed, you don't have issues. So that's a bit all the digital experience. We would like to predict your digital experience. The big telcos, they are also interested in diagnosis. So if there is something wrong, they would like to state that there is something wrong, that maybe come from your copper or your optical fiber, and also what need to be fixed. So to give that insight, for example, to the technicians. There is also a need for optimization. So sometimes you don't send directly a technician to fix something. If by a change of parameter, we can already improve the situation, we do that optimization. So there is plenty of AI in this business, and this is what I'm going to talk about today. So let's first start with a first use case, which is predicting the quality of experience, trying to predict your level of satisfaction. And actually, it's building a model between data that are measured by your gateway, your modem, and your experience at the end. And the classical path to do that is to capture all the data of a given network. So we are in the UK. Imagine all the country we can have access to the gateway. We can retrieve these data, and we can, for example, put that in parallel with all the customer complaints. So all the complaints of the end user that can be mapped using machine learning to build the best trained model between the data that are measured and your level of experience. But actually, if you do that like this, it looks quite simple and quite classic. But if you do that like this, it will not work, actually. It will not simply work. So what's the key to make the things working? It's actually the addition to the data science, which is good, but the addition and the combination between data science and domain expertise. And at the end, what we produce, it's not always the best trained model with the highest accuracy, but the one that worked the best in practice for the big telecommunicator or operator. So just to illustrate that there is a need and of the two components, so machine learning or data science and domain knowledge, I try to plot that into a graph to assess a bit the contribution of the two. So already at the definition of the scope and the requirements, so if we would like to predict, for example, that you have a low speed, is it feasible to do that only from the gateway measurements? Is it possible? So already there, to answer that question, you need to know a bit the domain and what data get measured by the gateway, for example. So what input data is also needed? The modem, they measure plenty type of speed at different layers, different levels. There are also, for a given layer, different notion of speed or bitrate. Is it enough or is it good enough for the use case that we have in mind? So that, knowing already that, it's basically mainly oriented by domain knowledge. And you can continue. When we retrieve the customer complaint, maybe that has been obtained in a special manner, so the process is a bit biased. So maybe the question that has been asked to the end user is a bit biased and doesn't reflect always the good category. How to measure the performance? Okay, we can build a good model, and at the end, we have a good accuracy, false positive rate, or whatever. But is it that matter at the end for the telcos? Or is it something else? I don't know, avoiding the churn or avoiding the complaint or the truck rolls that lead that is triggered by the complaint. So that need to be agreed as well. And already at that stage, we can also state, because you know the data, state if it's better to use machine learning or deep learning, for example. The second step, data transformation or KPI, this process can be a bit assisted by machine learning. There is some transformation that can be automated. But if you have a good domain knowledge that directly select the really relevant data and combine that a bit like here in a very skillful way. So in this case, we would like to arrive to a derivation of a bitrate budget. That's a bit the jargon, but there is a combination of many data measured by the modem. That combination is already pre-known by a domain expert. And if you have to relearn that with data science, you lose time or you can lose a lot of effort in relearning what any skilled expert in the domain already knows. Space transformation, that's classic, and that's more from a machine learning point of view. In the feature extraction, in this case, yes, feature extraction can be a bit more assisted with machine learning. But for scaling, ranking, balancing the feature, that's more automated. But for example, if you know that you have daily patterns or weekly patterns in your data, on Monday, your connection does not behave the same as on Sunday, etc., that already guides the window that you are using. So finally, that process, you can try any type of windows, but you save time again, and usually you save relevance, you gain in relevance by adding domain knowledge in that process. Pattern recognition, it's a bit a special step, because usually after the feature extraction, you directly feed your feature in a classifier. But if you do that with the problem that we have, that will not work even if we have good feature computed, because the target can be a bit unclear. So sometimes people fall for a problem that is not really existing. So they think, I don't know, my connection is dropping all the time. They mention that, but maybe it's not really your connection which is dropping, but it's maybe the modem that is rebooting. It's another problem. So the description of your problem can be a bit different. So that's a bit the mislabeling. And also, you can have non-applicable label. So for guys that say, I have a slow connection, maybe the slowness is not related to your broadband connection. It's maybe a server that is very slow. So in that case, you associate a target slow collection to data, and actually you don't have a matching between the two physically. It's not there. So we had to add this pattern recognition, but I'm going to give a piece of extra detail about that in the next slide. Why? Having a classifier, so doing the model summation and the modeling aspect, that is more a pure machine learning exercise, so the level of domain expertise is okay, still there, but lower compared to the other aspect. And finally, and that was I was referring to in the first line, in performance validation, we need, we can have a good confusion matrix and accuracy, but we also need really a real world validation, and maybe having a good accuracy or two models with the same accuracy does not present exactly the same real world performance. And what if it's good or if it's bad? We need to interpret and do some adjustment, and usually this adjustment, for example, relabeling the data or the process to capture the right complaint need to be changed. All these aspects basically are more addressed from a domain expert point of view than from a machine learning point of view. So all in all, machine learning is important. We all agree with that. But to guide that and to really to leverage the machine learning, there is really a need for domain knowledge. And we can see it's really important. So let's start with, let's come back to this pattern recognition. I was mentioning that you can have labels that are not applicable. So if conceptually we look at this axis as the axis for the speed feature. So this is from the left to the right. This is bad, this is very good. And here is the availability. So this is poor availability and very good availability. But you can see that sometimes you have speed issues or intermittent issues in that zone where everything is supposed to be good and good. So you don't see from your measurement out of your gateway anything wrong. Everything is brilliant, top speed, top availability, but guys are complaining there. So if you train actually simply your classifier out of this data set, you will end maybe with region like this, and you will start to learn things with a good accuracy, but it's not really relevant at the end for the business. So finally, having just a good accuracy, a good confusion matrix, sometimes it's not fully relevant for the business. So what we have developed internally within Nokia, it's a patented method, it's a way to really filter out the data that are not relevant. And what we try to do, and that will happen here, it's try to remove a bit the data that are not in the right region, let's say, or not applicable, while not biasing the rest of the relevant data. And so if you, after that, apply a classifier, that will produce the same accuracy with the same good confusion matrix. So from an accuracy perspective, that will be the same. But in this case, the region which have been learned are much more relevant for the business. So that's a situation. That's why I say if you just train with pure data science, that will fail. So that use case has been implemented using Apache Spark for ETL to handle a huge volume of data. If we collect the data from modem network-wide every day or several times per day during 1 month or 2 months, it's rapidly a lot of data. So you can arrive with more than 100 million rows. And we need to do some windowing and looking backward in time and do some pre-processing on that. So that's for that purpose Spark was used, and actually that was a kind of efficient Spark MLLib for clustering and classification. And also for the learning and the execution, we did that efficiently in a distributed way on top of Parquet file partition, in many partitions. So the Scala MLLib API was used because originally in Nokia we developed Java product, so we remain in the Java world. And also at that time, it's some years ago, the library was a bit more complete than the Python one, etc. And we were able to produce a jar file, and the jar file actually we can compile it. So from our side, we can a bit hide the code, but also orchestrate and execute it as Spark job in some other product that are Java based. Let's see. So in terms of performance, empirical algorithm, it's the algorithm that we had and the product that we had before using machine learning with classical self human made extracting feature and self rules, let's say. Okay, we had a gain of factor of 10. And with the addition of machine learning, so with the same feature extracted but with rules learned by a classifier, for example, there is a gain, the leaf improve. But when you add the domain knowledge, is what I was referring to, you learn better region, etc. The lift seems the same, but actually the value for the business is much higher. So in that sense, there is really an improvement to combine the two, machine learning plus domain knowledge. Now let's talk about deep learning. So deep learning, a second use case that is also very relevant for us. So again, operator, they would like to know if there is something wrong on your line and what needs to be fixed by the technician. So for that, again, we retrieve data out of your modem, and we have designed a deep convolutional neural network in order to do the mapping between what is measured by your modem and the potential problem that is on your line and need to be fixed. And again, to do that, it's not only purely data science, but for all these steps, even in the case of deep learning, building a good training set, domain knowledge was involved. And then I will explain that after. Soft labeling has been used, some addition of scalar feature, so not only CNN, classical CNN, and also for the validation process. So soft labeling, you all know this handwritten digist MNIST sample, but actually this training set has been already labeled by expert, you, me, or the author of the writing. You say that's a zero, and that's all example of zero. That's one, that's all example of one. So it's clearly formally labeled, and there is, at the labeling process, no ambiguity. While in our case, in the diagnosis for telco business, it's a bit different. Okay, I will not enter into all the details here, but for those who are familiar with signal processing or telecommunication, these are curves that represent the channel frequency response of your line, your DSL line, your internet connection. And actually, that's two examples of exactly the same problem. So in the field, on your line, there is one problem, but these are two examples. And but I'm explaining you that there is this one which is less severe than this one. So that problem is more severe than the other example. But it's the same problem. So if we just label saying it's that problem with that curve, the same problem, same label with another curve, then you will avoid this notion of severity. And for the business, technicians, when they see that, they go into and they repair. While when they see this, they say, no, that's nothing. We are not going to work on that. So again, that's a piece of knowledge that we need to have. So to handle this, we use soft labeling. But soft labeling, again, how to soft label this? And is it really the deepness of the peaks, or is it the fact that this curve is really below, the main slope is below that one? What matter, how to soft label it? So again, the domain knowledge will try to say, okay, that's a kind of reference curve, and the area between the dashed one and the solid one will be a good label, will be a good indicator of the severity. And we have used Apache Spark to process more than 20 million curves like that, and to apply the correct label, to derive the soft label for all the curves statistically. That's another example to show that this one is very, the general slope is very steep, but there is just a minor effect here, minor dip, and that's an example, again, of a lower severity problem. Expert scalar feature. So I said there is not only the convolutional stages here, but there is an addition of scalar feature added to the fully connected part to handle a proper classification. So actually, the rationale behind that is to have the perfect classifier, the perfect deep convolutional neural network, you would need to have the perfect training set. So we will need to train it perfectly with a training set that contains a lot of data from any category and any variation of the category. So the set has to be very large, various, and covering really all the spectrum of the problem. It's a bit like if you have images, you have cats and dogs, you need to have any kind of dogs taken in any position, in any type of lights, etc., etc. It's difficult to have this type of training set. And it's the case for everybody dealing with deep learning. So in this case, we have noticed that, okay, learning out of the convolutional stages is good. He learned features that we were not aware of. But if we add some key quantities that we know were useful, so for example, this general slope or the interception of the slope with the axis or whatever, we notice that adding this to the fully connected improves the robustness of the model. So sometimes when he sees an example that he has never seen before, instead of rushing with high confidence into a bad category, because of the scalar feature, now he's a bit more balanced. When it's something that he has never seen, he takes more care and he says it's probably this with, I don't know, 0.55 of confidence, and not saying it's that with 0.99 while it was wrong. So again, in this case, Spark was used, but mainly it's TensorFlow. So TensorFlow was used to design the CNN, to train it over millions of samples. Also, the scalar expert feature has been extracted in TensorFlow, and we store the model in session in the TensorFlow format. This time we were using Python also for the pre-processing, but Spark remained in use, for example, to compute statistically all this soft label, but also to distribute a bit the hyperparameter tuning to have an acceptable time, let's say. So if you train one model or 20 or 40 models, that's fairly the same amount of time. And the execution, if we would like to apply the TensorFlow model on Parquet files that are partitioned a lot, we can distribute the execution of this model using Spark. Again, in terms of performance, empirical algorithm, the historical one, designed by classical signal processing plus handmade rule. Okay, it's not a fair comparison because we actually can detect more problems than before with no deep learning, but for fewer coverage of problems, we had this type of performances. With addition of machine learning on top of handmade extracted feature, there is a gain. So just having a proper classifier bring a significant gain. Deep learning alone, just convolutional neural networks arrive to very high accuracy. And then, thanks to the addition of domain knowledge, we can see that it's fairly the same accuracy, but it improves a bit the false positive rate because of this scalar feature and because of this soft labeling. But mainly, and again, it's really the relevance for the business. So we only report problems that has a given severity. And this notion of severity is embedded in the confidence that is reported. We don't rush into the wrong category if we have a problem that we have never seen before, etc. So because of all of this, it's finally more valuable for the business. But globally, if you look at the confusion matrix, it's basically the same number. So as a wrap-up, data science gives always better results when you know what is behind your data. Increasing your domain knowledge will save you a lot of time, will make you a better data scientist. ML-DL model performing well in notebook may not give the expected quality or result in the field. So for the same accuracy, some are producing relevant insights for the guys in the field, then for exactly the same accuracy, you can have insights that are much less valuable. And we have noticed that DL model, deep learning model, perform better when guided with domain expertise. So there is a kind of theory saying that everything needs to be discovered and learned alone by the convolutional neural network. We have noticed that when it's guided from the training set or from addition of scalar feature in our case, etc., finally, at the end, that perform better when it's guided by domain knowledge. And the key to all of this, it's to get domain expert and data scientist in the same team. So it's better if your data scientist knows also the domain, that's better. But if at least you have these guys in the same team, finally, that's the key to the success. So thanks for your attention. And if you would like to know a bit more about our group and what Nokia is doing for your broadband connection, you can hit that link, Digital Experience, and you will see, we'll have more information about us. Thank you.
If you have any questions, raise your hand.
Thanks for the presentation. Just a question about the setting of the scalar feature.
The
scalar feature that you input, yes, in the CNN. Does the expert have to check the result on a sample and adjust the parameter regarding some test? Or?
No, actually, scalar feature, it's a kind of classical feature. So out of curve, a bit like that, you can derive quantities, like, for example, the average slope of this curve. Or does it intersect there, or, I don't know, somewhere below. So it's just, you have your slope, and you derive quantities that you know are normally relevant. And in this case, that a field technician would fairly look at, say, will look at the average slope. He will not check all the details, potentially, but he will look maybe the average slope or where it intercepts the y-axis. And that can be extracted by TensorFlow, right? Just a simple linear algebra, and then plugged to the fully connected part of the TensorFlow CNN.
So it's kind of derivative feature?
Sorry?
It's kind of derivative feature?
Yes.
Thank you for the presentation, really interesting. So the last example with deep learning and domain expertise, you said that the confusion matrix was the same, but the business value derived was that much higher. In what way was the business value higher?
It depends on how you will measure it. But in our case, we are in the telco domain. At the end, we have a kind of KPIs for the telco in terms of time to repair. If they repair your line faster, it means that they have identified the problem faster. That was the correct problem. They send the right team at the right place. So it's a way to measure end-to-end, if you want, the value of your insight, of your diagnosis. But that is a kind of end-to-end validation. But if you do that, you see that if you give good insights at the end, by sending the right guy with the right tool at the right place, etc., that will shorten the time to replace. While if you give a lower quality of insights, then they will, it's not correct, they will search again or repair something that is not necessary to be repaired. And then on average, the time to repair will not be so shortened, let's say. But from a confusion matrix point of view, you have label versus prediction, that will be the same. So here, before doing the soft labeling, you have a hard labeling. You can plot a confusion matrix. Then you introduce the soft labeling. Again, you train your classifier. You have another confusion matrix. But out of that, you have, in both cases, let's say, an accuracy of 97%. While now, with the soft labeling, you know that the problem where you only see very minor pattern, it's not reported with high confidence. So the technician will a bit not focus too much on these aspects. So they can prioritize on much problematic aspect, and that was correct to focus on the more problematic aspect. So they don't lose time doing too much task, and at the end, then the time to repair gets reduced, etc., etc.
Unfortunately, that's all the time we have. Let's have another round of applause for Nikolai. Nikolai.